Welcome back to the 16th Marketing Conclave, organized by IAMAI and powered by Z5. Ladies and gentlemen, we now move to the next panel discussion, Power of Vernacular. I would like to introduce you to the moderator, Mr. Abhinav Khare, CEO and board member, AsiaNet, and our esteemed panelists, Mr. Bharat Gupta, CEO, Jagran New Media, Ms. Mayura Shreyams Kumar, Director, Digital Business, Matrubhumi Printing and Publishing, and Mr. Jayan Mehta, Senior General Manager, Planning and Marketing, Amul. Welcome, everyone. I would now request Mr. Khare to take over.
Thank you very much. So today we will be discussing about the power of vernacular media. As all of us know, Indian internet is on the cusp of another almost like an explosion. Imagine the entire industry going back to 2000 when India when the internet was invented, and then I think the starting of Indian internet was more or less in 2005, between 2005 to 2010. Almost something similar has started happening from 2015 onward. That is, Indian internet is beginning to go to the tier two and tier three cities. And that's where a lot of new players are emerging. We have Jagran, which is, you know, one of the biggest, not only media houses, but one of the biggest internet media companies. We have Matrubhumi with us. We have Amul, which is very interesting because we will be able to get a very good sense from the client side as well. I mean, we have got three internet companies, and we have got the guys who are actually paying us so that we can continue doing what we do. So welcome, everyone. What I'm going to do it now is, and it's not really in the order of seniority or anything, but in the order on which people are appearing on my screen, I would request each one of you to just give a quick introduction of yourself and your company, what you do, and then we'll start taking up the question. So why don't we start with Bharat? Bharat?
Hi, Abhinav. Thank you so much. Hi, guys. Welcome to this panel discussion. My name is Bharat. I'm the CEO of Jagran New Media, the online arm of Jagran Prakash Limited. I think the primary role is how to make businesses more scalable and sustainable. And as a company, we truly believe in that our content is to enable people with factual and credible information and empower them with the power of knowledge, information, and help evolve a better India. So I think carrying on with what Abhinav said, that the new India or the emerging India is all about the audiences coming from tier two and three towns. And it is important to understand that what is their needscape, what are their requirements, how do they look at information, and what effect does it have on their life. And once we understand that, I think that is that would be truly symbolic of how the news companies can prepare themselves to better serve these audiences. So this is the philosophy we believe in. In terms of company, we have six websites spanning news, health, information, women, and a fact check operations. And today, I think in last 2 years, we witnessed a massive increase, and we are now able to reach out to about 106 million users online per month. So that's about us. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much, Bharat. Now we'll move to Mayura. Mayura, over to you.
Thank you, Abhinav. My name is Mayura Shams Kumar. I come from Kerala, from the group Matrubhumi Printing and Publishing. As you know, we are still a print-dominant industry. However, digital is growing for us in a very, very large way. What we look at, of course, credibility comes into a huge play here, but also we dive into hyper-local news, which is something that is of great interest to the people who live in Kerala. There's a sense of reliability and trust that we like to provide for our people. And more than that, you know, news is flooded everywhere, especially when you look at social media, you look at all the kind of avenues that is approaching that too in various languages. I think it's our job to make sure we give the right information to the right people. And I mean, to all the people, my bad. And we are actually a 97-year-old company. We started during the freedom struggle. It was led by K.P. Keshav Menon and K. Madhavan Nair. We existed because there was no source of information or any sort of communication with the people in the Malabar region. That's why we came up in the first place, and we continue to serve that purpose in a larger scale. That's what I would like to say about my company. Thank you. Thank you, Abhinav.
And it's incredible to see, you know, one of the oldest media groups in the country being led by someone so young. So, you know, a lot of transformation is happening in the industry, it seems.
Yes, yes, it is. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mayura. The next panelist is Mr. Jayan Mehta. Jayan, over to you.
As you know, Amul is India's largest food brand with a turnover of about 52,000 crores. And we are also now a 75-year-old organization. Almost we're completing 74 years this year. Not as old as the Matrimony, but yes, almost reaching there. We've been growing at the rate about 15 to 70% annually every year for the last decade. And we have a robust supply chain of 36 lakh farmers across 18,500 villages of Gujarat collecting more than 50 lakh liters of milk. Which is processed at 85 dairy plants and sold through a network of about 70 branch offices, 10,000 distributors and a million retail outlets across the length and breadth of the country. And since I'm the odd man out as a Doodhwala, we are actually in the same business. Because like newspapers, our milk pouches are delivered to doorsteps of the customers, and our products also subscribed, and we should follow the subscription model also. But the numbers, if I may put up, that we sell close to 350 lakh pouches of milk every day. So our reach and subscriber base is more than times Hindustan Times, Malayalam, Matrimony put together. So that's the kind of numbers that we have in reaching out to people. And as the business grows and the more deeper we get into the country to expand our market, one needs to understand the local sentiments and the local culture of the people. And also that we are a national brand competing with a lot of local players. So the local understanding is very, very important in our business, and that's why the regions, the geographies and the other things which come up. And that's why this session will be very interesting to understand both conventional and traditional media as well as the digital media. But I will end my opening remarks here with a note of dissent. I would object to the word vernacular here, because vernacular actually is a derogatory word.
I was just waiting for someone to object to that. Yes.
we have a tradition and a culture which is older than most others. And so with this, let's carry forward, Abhinav. We'll continue our discussion.
All right. So I think maybe I'll just change the name to the regional language of the Indian Language Forum, because I know originally the vernacular, especially you know, in the 90s, a lot of people within the metros, they used to use it in a negative connotation, right? But anyways, yeah.
And so, inspiration from the word, name Matrubhumi, we should use the word Matrubhasha, because that's what defines all of us. And I think if we look at the consumers from that perspective, I think as brands and as media, we have a lot to learn and a lot to gain. Okay.
Maybe now I'll give a quick introduction to AsiaNet. It's one of the largest media houses, media groups in South India especially. Our internet journey has been very interesting compared to a lot of others. We arrived pretty late, but then we did arrive. So 3 years back, we used to be Comscore rank 117th in the country. As of date today, we are ranked number 9, the only South Indian player in the top 10 in the country right now. A large credit goes to, you know, this amalgamation of the media DNA and the internet professional. Personally speaking, I come from startup industry. I've never worked in media. So we are basically bringing all this young blood and the aggression of the startup industry into a traditional. Actually, AsiaNet is the oldest news channel, the private news channel in the country. We started when even the satellite uplinking, downlinking used to happen from Russia. So from those days, now we have come here, and currently, you know, in the South India, I mean, as per the Comscore, the rating agency, we are larger than the next 14-15 competitors put together in South India. We are in 7 languages. I'm young and dynamic team, so that's about us. I think Now I'll move to the individual panelists about the stories. Let's discuss some stories. You know, what are the big challenges that you have faced, you know, in your journey? I mean, a lot of us, our journeys are not super old. I mean, let's say compared to the English players who started almost 20 years ago, a lot of us, our journeys are reasonably recent, you know, maximum 10, 12 years. So what are the biggest challenges? Bharat, I'm coming to you. Bharat, what is the biggest challenge that you faced and how did you solve that problem?
Thanks, Abhinav. I think it's a very interesting question. So 3 years back, we began with the same question. And 3 years back, the reach for digital in our company was maybe about close to 27 million or so. And we did a research and we tried to understand that we had the wealth of knowledge which came from the print background and positioned the newspaper very strongly. But what we wanted to decipher is that how is the consumption shaping up in India? Who is our audience? What are they consuming? When are they consuming, right? And most importantly, trying to understand why do they consume information? And I think armed with these five questions, we conducted a research and we tried to understand that how are people consuming information? What connects with them? What are their needscapes? And also very important that keeping in mind that India is a very diverse country, not only keeping languages and culture in mind, but also in terms of geography. So, you know, India is a true example of hyper-local connect. And people in certain areas first want to know what is happening around them. So this made the conversation very, very complex. And once we had these insights with us, I think the first amendment which we made to our strategy was that we tried to define the growth opportunities because not everything could have been done. And we very clearly tried to segment audiences into the audiences who are willing to consume news, the audiences which is youth, which is 60% of the country when it comes to the internet population. They need around education or health as a category, which is cutting all across, or even representing voice of women on internet. Because in India, even at 46% penetration, the women users are less than 30% of India online population. So if India has to increase, it was important to understand different audiences and segments across different genres. And with this, we began, a massive program to bring a lot of science and psychology into the editorial newsroom. And they started preparing, understanding audiences better and preparing different kind of content for different kind of audiences. I think this was one of the key strategies which we adapted. And once our content pipeline was in place, of course, the role of the right technology and in terms of amplification, in terms of surfacing of content, in terms of different formats like going beyond text to voice or video and things like that. Also, somewhere we felt that one of the disconnect with the medium of internet is that the physical or the real connect with the audience was missing. So we felt that can we derive a way to connect with the audiences and trying to understand them better? And that gave birth to a lot of community programs, which we launched as digital first initiatives, which translated into online exchange of information and even physical community programs at ground level, which gave us the ability to understand, reach out, interact with the audience in real, and you know, take that whole wealth of information, that feedback, and use it to power our content in a much more meaningful way. So I think when we started the journey, as I said, we were about 27 million, and in 2.5 years, we were able to increase to 100 million plus. So I think that's the biggest testimony to the need to understand audiences better and put them on forefront rather than just replicating what we were doing as companies.
Okay, very, very interesting. I'm going to come back to you, Bharat, have a couple of questions. But before that, I'm going to go to Mayura. Same question for you. What are the biggest, you know, challenges that you've faced? What are the interesting stories from your organization, from your journey over the last, you know, few years?
Firstly, it's just been, I think, around 2 months since I got to the digital stream. I was working with the radio before this, which is a completely different ballgame. But I think this is a challenge that all of us would be facing, I'd like to bring into light here, would obviously be the us being a huge market as Hindi. We are a Malayalam market where the population is much lower than most of the other places, yes? So first is that it's a very print-dominant market even today. When you look at the age demographics as well, you have, I think, a 40 plus more than the younger generation here. So first is the transformation itself in terms of saying, hey, why don't you subscribe? You know, that small point. Still the kind of revenue that's been sucked up by tech companies, where there's a very small portion left for the rest of the media companies, especially when you look at the Kerala market. So that would definitely be one of the challenges that I like to, you know, bring into light. Second would be, my main thing is, even though we are present like digitally, and even though we are growing in a pretty okay manner, there's still quite a gap to be filled in this market when it comes to digital consumption. Here, video is what is more relevant than, say, text or articles. Even though being such a literate state, this would be another challenge. And of course, politics. There's a culmination of information where we're still trying to get a hold of what is working where. But the main thing I feel is in terms of where is most of the market share or revenue going. I think that would be one of the biggest challenges that I'd like to bring about. We have been in digital actually before the times, you know, like 1998 is when we actually had a digital platform, especially with e-papers. So we went way ahead of our times there. And then like television came in years later, radio came in years later, we existed from then. But then again, subscription there is much lower because everybody wants a physical copy. So by the end of the day, yes, the transformation of the market by itself, a revenue transformation, what are the new things that we can, you know, we're still researching on what are the new things or what are the avenues that we can tap into here. Of course, politics and sports being the biggest. However,
any changes in the user's preference, especially after, you know, this latest COVID crisis, who obviously, Kerala has managed it in a much better manner. But yeah. I mean, because I also run a newspaper, Kannada Prabha. So what were your experience with that? Any changes in the user preference? I mean, are they more comfortable now with the distribution?
Yeah, of course, when there was a COVID spike, of course, you know, what was happening, where there's more of a knowledge passing happening here on how to be careful. There's people being a little more, you know, this thing. But I still feel after like 2 months, politics had a big role to play and it just barged in, you know, if you know what I mean. There were quite a few cases that came about even today, you know, with kind of a situation that's happening in the political scenario here. I feel that in Kerala, politics doesn't take a back seat. Maybe for a month or two. But after a point, you're back at the game for politics. So I think I would say that was a kind of shift that I saw later. And I think there was a certain sense of responsibility that was brought in by the entire industry to the people, which kind of helped us, I would say, in the beginning, the ideal model we had in the beginning, as of now, we are still in trouble. But in the beginning, we had that because there's a sense of responsibility also because of the kind of consumption also people did in our news channels and our news, this thing about taking precautions and how to go about it. So that is one dynamic. I don't know if you would agree with me on this, but but yeah, it's just one of the points I'd like to bring in.
See, I also work in one of the brands in Kerala. So, you know, let's agree to disagree or whatever. You know, we are extremely comfortable in discussing multiple things. So,
but the consumption, of course, that's what I'd like.
Jen, I'm going to come to you now. I mean, you are extremely fortunate, you know, like you work in a company which is one of the most loved ones, I think, probably, you know, other than Tata, and even more so, you know, Amul is always like, you know, apni company. It's like, you know, every Indian would have a strong connect. How did you do it? Tell me something interesting, you know, some case study that you've gone through, because when you're already so ahead of everyone else, it just seems that things are extremely easy. You know, you have your marketing campaign. You don't need to do anything. You just put something on Twitter and suddenly it is going viral. Your marketing is rocking. Your products, of course, I mean, your training part is there. The entire village, even by small towns, small village, small colonies, everyone just assumes that, oh, it is our company. So what is an interesting story that you could share with us?
Well, there's a lot of challenge and a struggle behind everything what you say. And but yes, brands go where the consumers are, and brands follow the consumers. And that's what Amul, at least we've been trying to do continuously, both in the earlier times and also in the modern times of the internet. As we talked about the internet, we adopted IT as a strategy and thinking like an IT company in food business way back in the 1990s. And we were among the first 5 companies in India to have a .com presence. So Amul.com came up before none of them knew internet as a country. But then ever since then, we've been also trying to understand the changing behavior of the customer and try to adapt our marketing strategies accordingly. I mean, the word Hinglish actually is a term which Amul Topicals have coined in the country today, because you can see Mia Kidat, Sharma, Gaya, Zahir, Abbas. So all the topicals, Amul reboot campaign going on since 1966. Earlier used to be in English, then it's blend of Indian English and now also pure Hindi. So we have to adapt to the changing mood of the nation and the changing lingua franca, and also the regions, and the, as we expand to the different geographies. Our MD, Dr. Sodhi, is very passionate about communicating to customers in their own languages. So all our campaigns are by and large thought from a mind of an Odia customer or a Tamil customer or a Punjabi customer or an Assamese customer, made locally, content created locally, produced locally, and for that local market. And so that's how we are focusing on creating content, both in the media assets as in television and film, and as much as in digital. Trying to speak to a Tamil lady who is a housewife for her recipe in a Facebook Tamil page run by Amul, as much as in a Bengal page in the recent times, of course. And there are we did more than 550 recipes in 11 different languages. So not just saying, hey, this is the English recipe or Hindi recipe on YouTube and try to adapt your making paneer butter masala in that style. We're talking to them in their own language so that they are able to adapt to the changing food habits which they are aspiring for with the Amul product in a very, very seamless manner. And obviously that goes along with expanding of distribution and trying to create new products which meet the requirement of the customers. But moving on to what Bharat had said, people are, and Mayura also said, that people are habitual about the newspaper. And I'll just share, going back to the Matrubhasha example, I read about 6 to 7 newspapers every day. Okay, but the first paper I pick up is a Gujarat Samaj. And the second paper is a very hyper-local Anand City paper called Naya Padkar, because Google News does not cover any of these news. And then there is Times of India and Economic Times and the Mint and the Express and the other papers there. But I have been clarifying that I have studied in English medium right from junior age. And so my parents have also done their graduation and post-graduation in English medium in the 1960s. But still, it's the mother tongue and the Matrubhasha which matters. And the customers want to connect to news and media in the language they are familiar with and they're comfortable with. I also know a few other languages like Marathi and even Malayalam. And for that matter, Hindi and Sanskrit which we studied in school. But the connect which we as brands and you as media should be looking at is speak to the person in his or her own language. I think that will take us a long way in whatever pursuit you are. We want viewership, we want customers. Both actually can marry these two together and we can create really wonderful consumer experiences and interactions as the time becomes more and more challenging, media becomes more fragmented, digital becomes all pervasive. And that's where we can be doing our job.
From Asianet, one story that I would like to share would be about a product part. You know, now lot of internet companies initially, what they were doing was they were just trying to pick things from West, you know, US, Japan, Chinese market, and just sort of replicating it for India. And then a lot of entrepreneurs, lot of internet companies in India, they assume the vernacular or the regional Indian language market is just going to be the same. You know, you take an English product, just change the language, copy paste it, and it will work. In our understanding, it was not the case. The taste, you know, the sensibilities, the DNAs, it was extremely difficult. So we decided, since we were, you know, we started quite late. Our journey started quite late. So we had the opportunity to do a lot of experimentations from the content side to deciding the categories to really the UI UX. You know, we in the first year, we changed our UI UX multiple times before we finalize something which clicked, you know, that basis on the A/B testing and all, we decided that, okay, this is the one where results are becoming very, very good. So we just allowed the data to decide the user interface. We allowed, you know, data to decide what categories, what kind of content we are going to create. And somehow that's how it really worked. So I think that is it. I don't want to, you know, bore people just with HNET stories. I'm going to come to Bharat now. I have one question, especially related to the media industry. If we see globally, a lot of successful media brands are the one which are gold standard in the traditional industry as well. I mean, you can take Washington Post, you can take New York Times, you can take BBC. So compared to the standalone digital startup, you know, the brands like Jagran, the brands like Matrabhumi, Manorama, Hindu, you know, even the Hindustan Times, the Times of India, these are traditional brands. So far, globally, we have not seen someone able to, you know, really change the trend. I mean, of course, we have a couple of success stories, but nothing comparable. What is, you know, the real strategic advantage for a company like Jagran? I mean, everyone knows you. So what really is working for you in the internet industry as well?
Oh, that's a great question, Arunav. So I think the legacy and the knowledge which Jagran as a company for us was able to create and generate over the last 75 years plus. I think what that really did was that it created a lot of trust and credibility for the brand name, right? And like, as we talked about Amul or, for example, Tata. So first things when you think about these brands are that they are trusted. They are very credible. You know, a brand like Amul would never cheat its customer by dilution. Or a brand like Tata, you're always proud to associate with, right? And so I think at the virtues level itself, what a traditional company has been able to create is a lot of trust and credibility. And apart from that, the next most functional thing is that the wealth of systems and processes to understand content, understand audiences, and to create that whole environment or a work culture of respecting news, I would say, because today, unfortunately, news has also become a commodity. And people and organizations have different purpose around news. Some want to use it to sensationalize the market. Others, they want to enlighten people. And some for very different reasons altogether. So I think for a lot of traditional companies, the core driving point was that you came out from a place where you wanted to enable people towards a progressive society, maybe, right? And the whole foundation of news then changes because always your emphasis is more on trust and credible. So for us also as a company, when we, after the research, decided to foray into non-news information segments like education or women or health, the most difficult thing to achieve was taking the torch of trust and credibility and looking at everything from that perspective. So I think this is what the real strength is. And in the digital world, it is not easy to carry forward this torch. And I think if we are able to listen, learn, and adapt to the new situation, like in terms of how do we pass on this as a trait to the next set of audiences which are online first, how do we make them realize the value of credible content, and how over a period of time through a very engaging environment you can earn their trust. And I think that's a ongoing challenge which all of us are going.
Yeah. Mayura, same question for you.
I think I relate to Bharat with a lot of points here. Now, for example, you take Oxford University. You keep your principles intact. You keep your the way your company was built, you keep that intact. However, you change your mediums or your ways of thinking, keeping the principles intact according to the times we have today. I think a huge, huge factor that place for, I would say, our kind of companies is credibility, for the fact that we've been here for so long. And of course, also, like, I think it's about dealing with some real issues sometimes. Let it be education, let it be health, let it be any sort of, let it be any segment we're looking at. There are some real core issues that we need to deal with. Now, for example, say the environment. I may be going off topic, please do.
Please carry on. No, that's fine.
Environment. So I think using this, it's our job to not only gain the trust of the people, but also kind of address what is happening around in a way that everybody is aware, informed, and also kind of ready for what's coming for them. I think that is something which traditional media, I mean, I'm saying when we go way back, it's been our purpose, and it should be our purpose continuing to do so. How did these giants become like? These guys, like, for example, New York Times, like, I think there's a huge amount of trust, which also kind of went into a huge amount of, say, subscription, or you give, say, that I will give you the correct news and I will give you what you need to know. And that's something that I feel as a company, as traditional media companies, we can carry forward. And is that more than that, it's our job to do so. So that's something that like
the convey. Thanks. Jayan, to you, I have almost similar question, but maybe, you know, slightly different in a way. 100 million monthly active users for a new age startup versus 100 million monthly active users on Jagran. Do you give particular preference to the heritage brands because of, you know, the entire credibility that they come with? Or as an advertiser, I mean, what's your opinion on it? Do you give preference to the traditional media? If yes, why?
It's a preference because of the legacy which they have and the credibility which they would have. Because it's after decades of efforts, the brand has been built and the foundations would be very strong as far as the reporting or the journalism or the editorial stance and other things are concerned. Having said that, the new medium also offers analytics and data. And in which, if you are able to identify that there is an overlap, then obviously there is no question of looking at the other option. You continue with what's going on well with you. In this case, the legacy strong brand. But if the overlap is not there, and if you are finding a new set of customers being attracted to content which is otherwise decent, I mean, you get numbers can be because of many other things. Okay. But if the numbers are coming from decent content and there is what content which the current traditional legacy brand is not able to do, then one would definitely look at that option available also. For a simple reason that as a brand, you look at people who are willing to innovate and try out new products also. So as much as we are in business of selling milk, butter and cheese, we also keep on launching new products and also want to reach out to new set of audiences who are innovators, basically wanting to try out new products. So with that mindset, you have to also look at people who are experimenting with different sort of players in the market or experimenting with their content. And if there is a match in the content with what our values and the ethics are, then obviously we would like to explore that also. So, and as again, I go back to us, our brand strategy also, not just advertising, but also creating content is one way in which we are looking at this media. So we don't depend on other content creators, we create our own content. So we every year we create a lot of content, and particularly during this COVID times, the Facebook campaign that we are running with chefs across the world, more than 1200 chefs doing 10 to 12 shows every day on Facebook, live on Facebook. We get close to crore views on Facebook overall, about more than 800 million views we have got over the last 4 months. And that is the kind of content, and more than 50,000-60,000 minutes of live recipe content which we have created is there on Facebook and people to do. So it's a mix and match of both. You have your own content strategy, you have your own communication strategy, and for communication strategy, go to credible, strong media partners who also give a multimedia flexibility. I mean, with Jagran, I can talk digital, I can talk print, I can talk radio, I can talk outdoors. I mean, so that's the kind of things that, and television also early, they launches Channel 7 also. So that's the kind of capabilities they have. And our agency and the media planners also enjoy dealing with such agencies because of the strength they bring on the table and the ability to cover a particular geography efficiently. Asianet, for instance, we've tied up with the Time Show, a recipe show for last several seasons. And it's going on not only received well in India and Kerala, but also in the Middle East where there's a huge Malayal speaking dialect.
Yeah.
So that's the power which these brands bring on the table, and we work with them to grow. Just to put numbers to our advertising spends, more than 90% of our total print revenue goes off to non-English, which is basically all the language newspapers. And if you keep Hindi and English television aside, more than 50% of the budget goes for regional channels. So that way, we are also trying to reach out and work with partners who are strong in every single state of the country, so that we are able to reach out to our TG, which is the housewives, and also the youth, and also to do communication of our production services.
Okay. So now we just have around 7 minutes left. So I'm just gonna, you know, request Bharat to quickly in 1 or 2 minutes summarize if there is any best practice or a learning that you would like to share either with your colleagues with media industry like us or with the new age entrepreneurs. What would it be?
Thank you. I think two fundamental or rather three cores which we as a company believe in is that investing into a organizational culture, and culture is a very important thing, and especially keeping in mind that the way changes are happening around us and how rapidly things are changing. COVID lockdown was one such example, and companies which were able to grow or demonstrate growth during COVID was not because they innovated only during the period of COVID, but because of the hard work which happened prior. So I think growing a culture within the organization is paramount. Second, adding to what Jayan said, that it is important to embrace the change, and legacy does not alone help you to walk forward. So a lot of innovation is required, and this is an age of innovation. A lot of experiments have to be done. So on one side, we need to constantly evolve our content plans to engage our audiences better. At the same time, we have to also innovate on how can we connect our audiences better with advertisers. What are the transparent mechanisms and solutions to demonstrate that connect, and, you know, work in partnership with our clients to solve a problem, right? And last I would say is always, apart from scale, it is also important to aim at sustainability. And I would go back to you, Abhinav, that during the early example of 2000s, when internet was still growing, and a lot of people thought that merely by imitation of examples from West would give them a great opportunity in India. And a lot of those companies, they came, brilliant yes. ideas, great products, but they disappeared. And yeah. again, that second wave came in towards 2010. And again, the same thing happened. So I think beyond scaling up, it is also important for digital publishers to realize that wherever we are right now, the mm-hmm. importance of making your businesses sustainable in that environment, because just scaling it up blindly will not take us anywhere.
And funny, it doesn't work. Thank you, Bharat. Mayura, in 30 seconds, because I think we are running out of time. That you'd like to share?
I think there's a sense of trust and responsibility that we have towards our community, which we must keep, whether you're a new player, whether you're a traditional player. And it's something that you definitely should take forward. Innovatively, keep the trust. Innovatively, given the correct information, let it be entertainment, let it be news. Innovatively, do it in a sustainable way. And yes, reliability is there on us. And I think we should always make sure that we stand on a plane, that we can always be the people that give you the correct information.
And from Asianet, I think the thing that I would like to share would be about the culture. I mean, I'm extremely proud despite being a tough year. Not a single employee has lost his job. We planned for it. We were slightly ahead in terms of, you know, the planning. Because of that, we managed. I mean, of course, it is a tough year. what I always believe for me, you know, like Amazon says that always being obsessed with the customer. For us, for me especially, I believe in being obsessed with the employee welfare, because those are the guys who are building our company. I mean, let's say unlike Amul, we are not producing any product. I mean, it's at the end of the day, it's just content, and content is produced by people. So we take care of people and they will take care of the business. So for me, this is the only learning from Asian. I think I still have last 1.5 minutes, Jayan, if you could, if you would want to share something.
So very simply, if large brands have to become larger, there is no choice but to go regional, go deeper into the country and understand the society in different parts of the markets and build your brand in a very strong way. And my message to you media companies is please remove the word vernacular from your dictionary. Think mother tongue. So creating content around the mother tongue of your customers, together we'll go a long way and build the respective businesses. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, everyone. Jayan, thank you. Thank you, Mayura. Thank you, Bharat. This was really lovely talking to you guys. And I know MI, you guys have been constantly pinging, but see, we are on time. In fact, we have 30 seconds to spare.
Oh, if I may add something.
Thank you. This was indeed an insightful session. I would also like to thank our valued partners, Z5, Infobit, Financial Express Bandwagon, Flipkart, and Jargon New Media. We now break for a quick 10 minutes. Stay tuned.
Thank you.
Thank you all.